Good morning. Welcome to Wycliffe Presbyterian Church on this Easter Sunday, 2021. We're thrilled you've joined us this morning as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is always our prayer that in these services of worship, you feel a closer connection to the Lord of heaven and earth. And so today, as we celebrate the resurrection, we begin our time together in prayer. Gracious and almighty God, in the midst of the joy of this moment, we give you thanks, for your Son, Jesus Christ, is risen from the dead. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Let us rejoice and give thanks to the living God. Amen. Whom do you seek in the tomb, O followers of Christ? Jesus of Nazareth, who is crucified. He is not here. He is risen, as he said. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Alleluia. Christ is risen indeed.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Alleluia. A triumphant holy day. Alleluia. Who did once upon the cross? Then let us sing. Alleluia. Unto Christ our heavenly King. Alleluia. Who endured the cross and grave. To redeem and save. Alleluia. But the pains which he endured, alleluia, our salvation have procured. The sky, he's King. Alleluia. Where the angels ever sing. Alleluia. Sing we to our God above. God's love. Alleluia. Praise our God, ye heavenly hosts. Alleluia. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, of well-aged wines, and rich food filled with marrow. And he will destroy the shroud that is cast over the people, the sheet that is spread over all nations, and he will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all their eyes.
The gospel lesson for this Easter Sunday comes from the 20th chapter of the Good News according to St. John, beginning with the first verse. Listen for the word of God. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and Simon Peter went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in its own place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their home. Friends, our story does not end there, though it easily could. Simon Peter and John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, look into the tomb, go into the tomb. They see that Jesus is not there at the word of Mary, and then they go home. But our story continues because Mary stood outside the tomb, weeping. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends our gospel lesson on this Easter Sunday. Let us pray. Gracious God, it's almost unbelievable. The tomb is empty. But Jesus is risen from the dead. Open our eyes and ears and hearts to hear this story and to recognize in it that you send your Son, O Lord, to be with us and to touch all of our senses. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, John's gospel kind of has it all. It's got intrigue. It's got mystery. It has a foot race between two disciples. It's got the ever stalwart Mary Magdalene deep in grief. In this story, we discover that the resurrection is more than just an intellectual proposition. The resurrection and resurrection life, life in Christ, is something that is lived each and every day. Serene Jones says that indeed, Jesus comes to us through our senses. I think she's right. Mary sees that the tomb is open, that the stone has been rolled away, and so she goes and she tells, which means the disciples hear. They come back to the tomb after this foot race. The disciples look in, they see, and they go home. Mary looks back into the tomb and sees angels and begs them to tell her, where have they laid Jesus? Finally, she sees Jesus and she doesn't believe her eyes. Well, she doesn't recognize him. How could she believe her eyes? So she asks him as well, and she hears his answer. We're kind of left to wonder if we were making a movie from this particular scene, would Mary stand staring at Jesus the whole time? Or maybe, being so deep into grief, she answered him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Maybe she turned away from Jesus and started to walk, expecting him to know nothing. Then her ears hear her own name. She turns around, cries out, "Teacher." She goes to touch him, and he says, "No, don't touch me yet. Don't hold on to me." And then she goes and she tells. We don't specifically have the sense of smell in this story, but I promise you, there would have been a smell. So between our frantic foot race and the confused grief of Mary, we have all of the senses engaged in this story. Now, I have to say, earlier this week, as I was getting ready for all of the various Holy Week activities, I had a thought, kind of a fleeting thought came into my head. The thought was a little bit arresting at the moment. And across my mind, I said, "I'm not ready for Easter. Am I ready for Easter? Are you ready for Easter? Are you ready to run to the tomb? Are you ready to look in? Are you ready to face the angels and the gardener? Do you know it's Easter? This time of year, this day of days, this event of the resurrection that the church celebrates not only for one day, but for 50. It's a life-changing kind of thing to be ready for Easter. And what does it mean if we don't feel like we're ready? I would say I don't know that Mary or the disciples were ready either. Not in this gospel and not in other gospels either. If you look at the Gospel of Mark, their story of the resurrection is even more Spartan. And it involves Mary Magdalene and also Mary, the mother of James, and Salome. They're headed to the tomb to bring spices to anoint Jesus. It appears that they are so convinced that he is very dead, probably because they watched him die, as opposed to all of the male disciples who went their own way. They're convinced Jesus is dead, and they go to anoint the body, to do the important work of burial, to do those tasks that must be done. In that gospel, in their overwhelming grief and anger and fear, the story is that those women get to the tomb, the stone is rolled back, they see a young man dressed in a white robe, presumably an angel, sitting on the right side of the tomb, and they're alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," says the angel. "You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth. He was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, here's where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples." And in Mark's gospel, they go out from that place and they flee from the tomb, filled with terror and amazement, and they say nothing to anyone. Of course, Matthew and Luke tell the resurrection from a slightly different perspective as well. But in all of these, we see the event of resurrection is not as triumphal as we celebrate it in our churches today. The women who go to the tomb are surprised, are scared. How can we be ready for Easter? Jesus rises from the dead. One scholar said, "Resurrection is not the same as resuscitation. Things will not be as they always have been. Resurrection is what we're after here. We're not looking to just simply restart a heart. We're looking for new life. That's what Christ offers. And that new life envelops all of our senses, like the flowers blooming in spring with their strong scents and the pollen that clogs our noses and makes us cough. New life in Christ is a beautiful, wonderful thing that meets us whether we're running in a foot race with the disciple that Jesus loved or whether we are overwhelmed and confused by grief and anger and fear. Jesus Christ is risen for you and for me, for the whole world, and He comes, walks among the world in His resurrection glory for us and for our healing. Mary recognized Jesus when He spoke to her, when she heard her name uttered by His voice. We know that names are special things. God calls each of us by name to the new life of the resurrection in Jesus Christ. And in these gospel accounts of the resurrection, whether it's from John's gospel or Mark's gospel or Matthew's gospel or Luke's gospel, there's a tension of the joyful, wonderful news that Jesus is risen and the frightening proposition, what in the world does that mean? Well, it means death doesn't have the last word. And as we have battled a pandemic for over a year now, that's important for us to hear yet again. Some of you may have seen news this week that the recent poll out has shown that for the first time in about 100 years, the number of Americans who claim to be part of a church has dipped below 50%. On this day of resurrection, There is so much hope. And there is hope because in the accounts of the resurrection, no one has everything all together. All of the disciples are trying to figure it out. All of the women who go to the tomb are surprised. Writing about the end of Mark's gospel, Beverly Roberts Gaventa says that only God's faithfulness will complete this story. I think that's true for us today. Only God's faithfulness will complete this story. And the God who split open the heavens at Jesus' baptism and tore the curtain in the temple at Jesus' death will be put off neither by our failures, nor our infidelity, nor by our most sophisticated interpretations. The good news on this day of resurrection is not simply that God wins, but that God wins with us in a new life together. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
Christ has risen while earth slumbers. Christ has risen where hope died. As he said and as he promised, as we doubted and denied, let the moon embrace the blessing, let the sun sustain the cheer. Confirm the rumor, Christ is risen, God is
My friends, let us pray. Gracious God, all the prayers we offer through your Son, Jesus Christ, who is risen from the dead, and through whom the Spirit gives life to each of us. In the risen Christ, we pray for the church. Let us be Easter people who live in the power of the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. And let us be salt and light for the world, encouraging the downtrodden, standing with the marginal, resisting oppression in all its forms. God who brings life out of death, hear our prayer. In the risen Christ, we pray for the earth. Let us be healers of your good creation, O God. Let us, through our actions, be the men and women who mend the earth and its creatures. God who brings life out of death, hear our prayer. In the risen Christ, we pray for all nations. Let us be agents of your love for all the peoples of the earth, especially for nations torn by war and crippled by the coronavirus. God who brings life out of death, hear our prayer. In the risen Christ, we pray for our communities. Let us extend care and compassion to those who are grieving and fearful. Let us be especially attentive to those who have faced violence in our communities. And help us to realize that when some are crucified, all are crucified, and empower us for justice and to seek justice in our neighborhoods and all throughout this land. God, who brings life out of death, hear our prayer. In the risen Christ, we pray for loved ones. Let us be agents of hope for those who are fragile in our families, churches, and community. And help us to comfort the afflicted. God, who brings life out of death, hear our prayer. We pray all these things and so many more that are weighing down our hearts and on the tips of our tongue. We pray them all in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, this is the Lord's table, and our Savior invites all who trust in Him to share in the feast He has prepared. Remember, once, in an upstairs room, Jesus sat at a meal with His disciples. During the meal, He took bread, and when He had blessed it, He broke it and said, This is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Later, He took the cup, and after He had given thanks, He said, In this cup is the new relationship with God made possible because of my death. Drink it, all of you, to remember me. This cup, this bread, the body and blood of Jesus Christ are given and shed for you. Take and eat.
How beautiful.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in His grace. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. My friends, go now from this place, from wherever you are. Live into the new life that comes on Easter. The new life that comes from resurrection. You have taken the body and blood of our Savior. You are ready for Easter. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift His countenance towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Christ is risen, shout Hosanna, celebrate this day of days. Christ is risen, hush in wonder, all creation is amazed. In the desert, all surrounding, see a spreading tree has grown. Healing leaves of grace abounding bring a taste of love unknown. Christ is risen, raise your spirits from the caverns of despair. Walk with gladness in the morning, see what love can do and dare. Drink the wine of resurrection, not a servant, but a friend. Jesus is our strong companion. Joy and peace shall never end. Christ is risen, earth and heaven nevermore shall be the same. Break the bread of new creation where the world is still in pain. Tell its grim demonic chorus, Christ is risen, get you gone. God the first and last is with us. Sing Hosanna, everyone.